Right.
If you were from, like, Eastern Europe, let's say, you may spell knife N-I-F-E. But he doesn't. He spells it with the K, the silent K. K-N-I-F. Leaves out the E. You would never write it like that.
Yeah, and that was part of what led to the belief that it must be a foreigner because a good Britishman would never do this, and, you know, that it was must have been that guy from Poland that they were looking at for a while, and that it must be Jews or whatever.
Yeah, I mean, that guy, I mean, first of all, I don't know, you know, when you talk about the Ripper and the murders, I mean, one thing you have to remember is these women didn't scream. They, no one heard them scream. One of them was outside of a window, right in the people who were basically awake, and no screams were heard, and she was abdomen was cut up. So whoever did it had to have enough power and strength to really subdue them. Mm-hmm. These are women. These are women of the what we call the unfortunate class. They basically lived day to day. They went out. They sold their bodies. They got some money. They went back to a das house and they lived. They fought. Like one woman, a week before she died, was in a bar fight where she got, you know, facial wounds and chest wounds because she was arguing over a bar of soap. A guy who's 100 pounds, she would have attacked, or did her best to make some noise. Not one of those four Ripper victims made any sound at all. I mean, that shows you the power behind the person. And Arthur Conan Doyle, he was one powerhouse, a boxer, sealer, whaler. He could climb up water pipes. I mean, the guy was an animal. I mean, he was so strong.
And he had, with just a flick of a wrist, could cut a throat.
Oh, I mean, absolutely. He could steal a kid in seconds.
Yeah, so because of that whaling experience. All right, real quickly, I want you to address the they now call me doctor line, and then we'll get to the calls for Dr. Daniel Friedman. Go ahead.
Oh, of course. You know, when you put that in the letter too, you're trying to throw people off the track. I mean, now they call me a doctor now. Another clever way of steering you in the wrong direction when you think you're back on the right direction. And they thought he was a doctor now, of course, because some of the coroners said that what this killer did at the crime scene in just a matter of minutes was actually purposely done. Ripper number four victim actually had her belly slashed open. Now, if you were a homicidal maniac or a butcher, let's say, when you were cutting open the abdomen, you would just go straight down, like with one swoop. But the Ripper didn't. He actually avoided the belly button and made a circle around it, which is a surgical procedure, like a naval flap. Cutting into the uterus of one of the victims, the coroner said this person knew exactly what they were doing, and if it had more time, would have done a masterful job of surgery. So the person who was committing the crimes had speed and knew what they were doing. Now, of course, other doctors have been implicated. Like, when I was a kid, I always thought it was the Queen's Royal Physician, William Gull. And that was the first person I had to, like, figure out could he have done it or not, because if not, my whole theory goes down the tubes. Well, I found out that William Gull was 72 years old at the time of the murders, suffered a stroke about a couple of months before the murders, which left, like, your dog, unfortunately. Recovers nicely, but...
Thank you, he's doing okay.
Yeah, but this doctor had a stroke, did not recover, and his right side of his body was paralyzed. So, I mean, you had a picture, 72-year-old, pretty much out of shape, cradling his right dominant arm down the street, chasing a 42-year-old woman who could fight off a guy.
Right.
And there's no way this was the man who did the murders.
Right.
You know, and some people say, like, you know, Prince Albert Victor, but, I mean, you're talking about a member of royalty here. I mean, if he was walking down the streets of Whitechapel, and people did see that, you know, glimpses of the Ripper, you see the Duke, you know, the Prince walking down the street, you're going to go, oh, my God, what is he doing in Whitechapel? He doesn't belong here.
All right, well, and so I'm going to move on to the calls before we lose them, because I've been holding on a little bit to talk to you. But then before we go, I'm going to leave enough time to ask you about the name that was sealed in an envelope.
By Joe Bell.
Yeah, okay, we'll get to that coming up. So first of all, first-time caller line, Jerry is in Los Gatos, California, on Coast to Coast AM. Dr. Dan Friedman, The Strange Case of Dr. Doyle. Go ahead, Jerry.
Yes, Daniel, you're unique. You're putting something out there that sounds wild, but it's probably not as wild as it sounds. What better way to become a great writer than to pull one over on the public with a murder.
Right.
Or a jury.
The perfect murder, the perfect crime, as Moriarty was always
in pursuit of. Well, remember, you're popularizing crime. You know, you're trying to... Remember, the first two Sherlock Holmes books, you know, A Study in Scarlet and A Sign of the Four, were flops. Doyle made absolutely no money off of those. You know, if you're trying to sell, you know, murder mysteries, or you're trying to sell detective stories, yes, what better way is it to sensationalize it, have it all over the press? And I'm not saying that's what he did, but certainly people got a sparked interest in, like, reading detective stories. Because remember, the detective story was kind of new. It was a new genre. I mean, Edgar Allan Poe is basically the creator of detective fiction, and Doyle was, and he tells you in A Sign of the Four and A Study in Scarlet, that he wasn't really a big fan of Edgar Allan Poe. He thought the stories were just too basic and simple. The Ripper crimes are not basic and simple. They are executed perfectly, orchestrated, arranged perfectly. Same as the Sherlock Holmes stories. They are brilliantly put together, constructed, and people read them and went, wow, you know, this guy's really giving you an accurate description of how things go. I mean, when you read Edgar Allan Poe, it takes you 6 months to figure out who the killer is. Sherlock Holmes tells you, no, I could do that in like a day. No,
well, that's
would take that long.
Or to his point about simplicity, though, the purloined letter, I believe it was, from Poe, is really like, it's a kid's puzzle, right? I mean, it's nothing. It's not complicated. So I kind of get where he was coming from as he reads those and then thinks, well, I can do better than that.
And
he does.
I mean, he's really the simple now. You know, you don't see, you know. It's the Sherlock Holmes silhouette that's really the symbol behind detective fiction now. Even though he's not the creator of it, he really just popularized it. And he popularized it at the right moment. He popularized it during a massive... This is London. I mean, it was the most populated city in the world in 1888 when the Ripper crimes were done. But it was like a seismic wave. It like radiated across the globe, the Ripper crimes. I mean, you were reading about this in every country of the world. Japan, which just basically opened their doors to the Western world, was reading about it. Australia, America, South America, everybody was reading about this. And what better way to kind of like keep it going, even though the murders were kind of done, was to read this detective fiction. And who better than
Sherlock Holmes? Joe is east of the Rockies on Coast to Coast AM for Dr. Dan Friedman, the Strange
Kid. Established that he wasn't squeamish. He battered the seals. I have two quick questions. One was this after the Victorian era in London where women were out and about and kind of freely socializing at night? And my second question is, you just mentioned the first two books. Were they written before the
stories? Crimes? They weren't books. They were stories. But go ahead.
Stories, rather. Stories. Were they written before the murders or after the murders?
Those are great questions. First of all, the murders took place during the Victorian era, because the Edwardian era didn't occur until the early 1900s. So these were. The fine young ladies of London were always walking chaperoned and very with people and hoity-toity. And the East End was this area where women, kind of like the unfortunate class, lived. And they were out at night, and they had to sell their bodies to make money to live in doss houses. The stories that you're mentioning, one of them was written in 1887. So that would be A Study in Scarlet, was written in 1887. A Sign of the Four was written a couple of years later in 1891. And that one actually has a lot of those clues that relate to the Ripper crime. So A Sign of the Four really has nothing to do with it, but it does have a lot to do with things such as infidelity and revenge. And also has elements of Arthur Conan Doyle's childhood in there, which I actually discovered the secret origins of a professor that he writes about when he's 14 that actually tried to kill him, Mr. Kriya. Because Kriya is actually an anagram of the word reach. And reach was the clue that was written on the wall in A Study in Scarlet. And the word reach means actually revenge. So that's what these murders were, an act of revenge. And that's what he was trying to show you in that one. And Mr. Kriya, being the anagram being of Rage of Revenge 2, was that he wanted revenge on his mother for figuring out that she was having an affair with her medical student lodger.
Yeah. So it leaves me just enough time to get to the famous incident where with the investigating physician, right? Bell?
Was
that
Bell, who's actually he's actually one of the role models for Sherlock Holmes.
Right. And they're both Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, and what was one of the role models for Sherlock Holmes, this doctor who was so good at picking up even on the smallest clues.
Right.
That they both wrote on a piece of paper and put into an envelope the name of the person that they thought had done it, based on the autopsies. Is that correct?
That's what rumors have it, and it probably is true. And when you think about it, you have to remember, Joe Bell is a Scottish physician. You know, he is Edinburgh. So he was able to figure out the name of Jack the Ripper from some type of medical evidence, meaning that he understood the type of surgical incisions being done at the crime scene and the type of man that could have done it. If Joe Bell would have realized that the Ripper took out a kidney, which is very, it's not easy. You open up a belly, you see a kidney. You don't. It's difficult to find. And as a matter of fact, most operations on the kidney were done from the back. But the Ripper, in pitch darkness, it was the darkest corner of Mitre Square, was able to reach in, find her kidney, take it out in sheer darkness, and then take it home with them, and also poke holes in the liver of the victim. And you have to remember that Bell would have known that the professor, William Rutherford, was doing those experiments with Doyle, in which he was opening up the windpipes, which is slashing their throats, opening up their abdomens, and sticking cannulas or poking holes in the livers. And if Bell would have put two and two together, that the person had surgical skills that come from Edinburgh's training, because it was the best hospital in the world at the time, at least one of the top in the world, whose procedures were very different from everybody else's, and was doing things very reminiscent of William Rutherford's work. If Bell put two and two together, he may have come up with a name. I think it's the student I had, Arthur Conan Doyle.
But if it's true that Sir Arthur Conan Doyle wrote down who it was that he believed it was and put it in an envelope, and they were the same person, as the rumor goes, as the historical story goes.
I don't know about Arthur Conan Doyle's involvement in that part. I do know about Joe Bell's, and that's the story I know, too. It's hard to really know what was what. I don't know if Arthur Conan Doyle would have written down his own name.
Well, that's the thing. Well, that's the part I was going to ask you about, because this is a story I've heard related before, that they both wrote down the name of that person, and then they both sealed in an envelope, and then they were unopened later on, and they were the same name. And some people have said, well, that's proof of blah blah blah, you know, that was that they both agreed that it was the royal physician, or they both agreed that it was so, and these are the two most brilliant forensic minds of their time, and that they both agreed that it was the same person. What would that be like if, at the end of the movie, so to speak, he puts, you know, Dr. Joseph Bell puts down Sir Arthur Conan Doyle in an envelope, and Arthur Conan Doyle puts down me in an envelope, and they just put the same.
Incredible movie. I mean, as I said before, with this thing he wrote into the Portsmouth newspaper, he actually writes, basically, he's writing about me, that the whoever Jack the Ripper was had a nice clerkly hand, which he had, was very known to write, which he was a writer. He spoke with he knew Americanisms. He knew them. He would use the word "dear boss." He did. I mean, he's actually giving you almost confession that he's the Ripper with his investigation, as if he was Sherlock Holmes. It's like Sherlock Holmes is finding out that it's my own creator that is Jack the Ripper.
Yeah. All right. Well, that's where we'll leave it for now. But so, enjoyed your book. Loved the way you laid it out. Thought that was very creative. The Strange Case of Dr. Doyle, A Journey into Madness and Mayhem, one of the co-authors, Dr. Dan Friedman. Thank you so much for your time. Nobody has to go there for open lines. I can't answer the questions that he would know the answers to. So where are you going to take us? Coming up next on Coast to Coast AM, this is Ian Potter.
Dean Sharp here. Nothing disrupts your life, your comfort, even your safety like a power outage. And outages are the new normal. So now is the time to set up your home with an emergency generator from Duffy Power. Duffy is Southern California's generator experts. And with 0% interest financing, emergency power, totally affordable. Duffy Power, making sure your life, your comfort, and your safety are not to be interrupted. Dial #250 on your cell and say Duffy Power. #250, Duffy Power, or on the web at DuffyPower.com.
Hi, this is Larry Miller from Sit and Sleep. You know, there's a lot that's new at Sit and Sleep.
Yeah, like me. Hi, I'm Drew Miller, Larry's son, and I'm proud to be the third generation of the Miller family to work at Sit and Sleep.
Only Sit and Sleep has BedMatch that scientifically recommends the right mattress for you.
Plus, you can shop the way you want, in-store, online, or a combination of the two.
And we'll beat anyone's advertised price or your mattress is free!
You still got the pipes, Dad.
Thanks, son.
Critical thinkers want it.
I was at a Starbucks and my sister was calling me. I looked at it and I hit ignore, but I didn't realize it. She was also in Starbucks and just wanted to surprise me.
The Tim Conway Jr. Show.
That was a tough one to get out of.
Weeknights at 6
on KFI. That's amazing that he was able to keep that many guns in his house.
You know, he should have gone to one of those gun buyback programs. He could have got $200,000 worth of Ralph's cars.
I think if he had gone to one of those programs, it would have set a record for one of those programs.
Yeah, it wiped him out. The Tim Conway Jr. Show. Weeknights at 6 on KFI.
Do you get excited to go to Walmart or Target or Costco?
I ask, like, on a Saturday or a Sunday. I'll say to my wife, my daughter, I'm like, hey, you guys want to go to Walmart? And if they both say yes, I'm like on cloud nine, man. I can't wait to get there and see what's on the shelf.
Tim Conway Jr. Show, 9 to 6 on KFI.
You voted for all this. Now, what, you're going to move to a state where there's far less of these progressive whack jobs and say, wow, life is better here. None of this bad stuff happens by accident. It happens because of choices we make.
John and Ken,
it's our fault.
Weekdays, 2 to 6 on KFI.
KFI. Los Angeles, Orange County. Live everywhere on the iHeartRadio app.
Possible free speech? I'm Brian Brumman from the KFI 24-hour newsroom. A lawyer claims a conspiracy indictment against six guys from Southern California in connection with the Capitol insurrection is politically motivated.
The federal charges against former La Habra Police Chief Alan Hostetter and five others includes obstructing an official proceeding and unlawful entry to a restricted building.
What's clear in the indictment is he did not enter the Capitol. He's not alleged to have used any weapons, and he didn't commit any acts of violence.
Lawyer Bill Asaley represents Hostetter, who's been accused of saying execution is the just punishment for the ringleaders of the coup.
Certainly he has a First Amendment right to express his viewpoints on the election, on whether it was stolen, and whether he believes that was a form of treason. That's his political viewpoint.
The feds accused the group of conspiring to block the victory of President Joe Biden. In Orange County, Corbin Carson, KFI News.
The LAPD says an illegal street race caused a car crash and house fire in Hancock Park. The cops say the driver of the car that hit the house Thursday night was killed, but the family in the home was okay. LAPD Captain Brian Wendling tells KTLA they have at least one witness.
The witness was doing about 45 miles an hour and said that the cars went by there at a high rate of speed. The witness estimated the speed somewhere around 90 miles an hour.
The fire started in a garage attached to the house and then spread to the attic and trees in the yard. LA fire crews put it out within 30 minutes. A judge has blocked the placement of a sexually violent predator in a neighborhood in La Crescenta. Calvin Grassmere was committed to the Department of State Hospitals in 1999, but was ordered released last November. People in La Crescenta have protested his proposed placement in their neighborhood. Even LA County Sheriff Villanueva said the court should consider alternative areas to put Grassmere, other than residential communities in LA County. The case is due back in court in 2 weeks. A man in Massachusetts says he feels lucky to be alive after a biblical encounter with a whale. Michael Packard works as a lobster diver, and he says he was diving off the coast of Cape Cod Friday when a humpback whale swallowed him up.
I thought, well, what if I just stay in here until I run out of air? I could be in here another half an hour.
Packard says he was in the whale's mouth for about 30 seconds before the animal spit him out. He was quickly rescued and treated for a broken leg. Experts say humpback whales aren't aggressive, and the animal probably swallowed the man accidentally. SoCal weather from KFI. Mostly clear skies in the LA Basin and at the beaches. Lows in the 50s. Clear skies in the afternoon. Hot in the valleys. Highs will be up in the 90s by the afternoon. Right now it's 61 degrees in Sherman Oaks, 61 in Culver City, 57 in Brea, and 59 in Irvine. We lead local from the KFI 24-hour newsroom. I'm Brian Berumen.
Ongoing problems in Hawthorne on the westbound side of the 105 before the 405. Three right lanes closed for police activity or jammed back to Hawthorne Boulevard. In Santa Monica, westbound side of the 10 between 4th Street and the McClure Tunnel, all lanes closed by Caltrans till around 6 a.m. Pacific Coast Highway also closed as part of this project between Ocean Avenue and the California Incline, both directions there. And in Sylmar, at the eastbound side of the 210 between the 5 and Roxford, all lanes shut down by Caltrans all weekend long till around 5 o'clock Monday morning. KFI in the sky helps get you there faster. I'm Robert DeBucky.
We all have wished at one time or another if we could just do two things at the same time. Well, if you're about to refinance or purchase a new home, here are two things you should absolutely do at the same time. Apply with at least two lenders. Mark Tice here from HMS Capital. Having two loans processed at the same time accomplishes a couple of important things. First, it maintains continuing competition for you, the customer, right up to the finish line. This results in a lower interest rate that saves you money. Second, it improves your chances of a successful transaction by eliminating the dependence on a single lender. HMS Capital requires no advance fees to apply, there's no appraisal fee, and no credit fee. With our razor-sharp interest rates, we are completely confident that no matter how many lenders you apply with, we will win your business. So call HMS Capital today and let us show you how doing two things at once really can save you money. Call HMS Capital at 833-255-5698. 833-255-5698. That's 833-255-5698. Or go to HMSCapital.com.
HMS Capital Funding is a DBA of Golden Gate Bank, NMLS ID number 2427. HMS Capital is licensed by the Department of Financial Protection and Innovation under the California Residential Mortgage Lending Act. License number 4130360. Equal housing lender.
Contractor license 1047781.
Hey, Keenan Winnie, what Rick told us is pretty cool.
It's Ken. You know it's Ken. I need to hear you say Ken.
Rick runs Gettle Academy, where we train plumbers and AC techs.
Rick told me something that made me so happy I had to wipe tears off my cheeks.
A student said, I knew working at Gettle was going to be a great opportunity, but I didn't know it was going to change my life.
That's what it's all about, Wacky Zacky.
When you work at Gettle, you know you matter.
You know you're making a difference.
Your customers and your co-workers love to see you coming.
And they miss you when you're gone.
Other companies expect you to upsell the customer.
But Gettle techs have only one job. Make the customer happy they called us and trusted us to fix their problem.
Ken sits down with all the new people once a month and talks about the future. And answers all their questions. And learns all their names.
I sit down with everybody once a month just to hear what's on their mind.
Come to work for Gettle. G-O-E-T-T-L.
You'll be happier than you've ever been.
Masks don't slow us down, they keep us moving. From the corner store to the coffee shop. On your bike. Or on the playground. Keep wearing a snug-fitting mask with multiple cloth layers. Together, we can end this pandemic. Visit covid19.ca.gov today to learn more. Brought to you by the Center at Sierra Health Foundation.
September 10th, 2001, one block from the World Trade Center. Security cameras capture the last known images of Dr. Sneha and Philip as she shops. The next day, chaos. Missing on 9/11 is the podcast that seeks to answer the question, what happened to Sneha?
There is not a trace of her. Nothing. Not a credit card transaction, no money taken out of her account, no emails, no phone calls. Nothing. How does that happen?
Listen to Missing on 9/11 on the iHeartRadio app or wherever you get your podcasts.
Fires will be more fiery.
Droughts will be droughtier.
Yeah.
That we're kind of looked at one.
Yeah.
Oh, it's new. Handle made the word this year.
Floods will be floodier.
Tornadoes will be
tornado-ier.
Yeah, I don't know. That sounds kind of stupid.
Okay. Oh, that one's
stupid. I got it.
Mornings from 6 to 10 on KFI.
KFI, AM 640.
Shove the miracles and talk to the side of the glass and fend the base of mushroom on the body ground. The wolves are pink and sour.
To talk to Ian Cummins, call the Wildcard line at 818-501-4109. The first time caller line is 818-501-4721. To talk toll free from east of the Rockies, call 800-825-5033. From west of the Rockies toll free, call 800-618-8255. This is Coast to Coast AM with Ian Cummins.
I love that song. Love the shout out to Jack the Ripper in the middle of Life is a Rock, but the radio rolled me. I could probably, when I sing along to that song, I can get it about 70% right. That's about it. The rest, I don't know. Try as I may. Now, as for you, I hope you enjoyed the discussion about Jack the Ripper. If you missed it and you're a Coast insider, you can go back and catch those first 2 hours anytime you feel like it. And just find out more at coasttocoastam.com. The introductory price is so small. You get a sample of all the things that are wonderful in it, including the Art Bell Vault. And you can, if you missed it, catch the strange case of Dr. Doyle from Dan Friedman. We don't have to keep talking about Jack the Ripper. We can talk about anything you want. That's the whole purpose of Open Lines. So where are you going to take us next on Coast to Coast AM? This is Ian Punnett.
We have a great story from someone who's helped themselves to heal by using the botanical known as Carnivora. And we have a guest right now. Her name is Joni Nichols. This is quite a story.
Yes, it is. And Robert, my adventure started about 7 years ago. I was a mess. I had numerous infections. My hair was falling out all over the furniture. Mm-hmm. One of the scariest things was that my legs were swelling up out of control. It came to a head. Within 24 hours, I had gone into a coma.
Holy tamale.
Mom and Dad decided to get me Carnivora's six-week program.
And at what point that you started this series did you notice, hey, something might be getting better?
Within two weeks, Robert. The first thing I noticed was that I felt better waking up. Then I noticed that my hair wasn't all over the furniture. I'm like excited.
It's like you said that within about 6 weeks, your legs were no longer swelling?
Within 2 weeks.
And she credits all of it to her Carnivora protocol, the B program, where she's using the Carnivora extract, the lymph drainage product. And I endorse it. I utilize it. My wife is using it with great success. This has been such a rapid recovery that I guess we had to do it. Joni, thanks for being with us. I love to hear from you again.
Great.
Hello, people. George here. Carnivora is at it again. Just listen to that. Call 1-866-836-8735. That's 1-866-836-8735 or visit carnivora.com. C-A-R-N-I-V-O-R-A. That's carnivora.com. Call them, please.
Credit Karma Money is a new checking account that lets you win daily instant karma purchase reimbursements on items up to $5,000. And when you make a purchase between June 8th and June 30th, you'll be entered to win $1 million. Visit creditkarma.com/winmoney. Instant Karma is sponsored by Credit Karma. No purchase necessary. Exclusions and terms apply. See rules. Banking services provided by MVB Bank, Inc. Member FDIC. Maximum balance and transfer limits apply.
Well, I'm open lines, never know what's going to happen on this show, and every time I think we found a theme, it kind of often takes weird turns. So let's start with the guy who's been hanging on the longest, and that would be, well, let's just go with Bill in Los Angeles on a wild card line on Coast to Coast AM. Bill?
I am.
Hey.
As a former history teacher and newspaper writer, I have what I hope is a falsifiable empirical theory about UFO about
falsifiable, UFOs. You said?
Yes, because that's the nature of a real theory, that it can be potentially falsified instead of just confirmed.
Yep.
So, in 1952, as you well know, there were two flyovers of what appeared to be hundreds of what were described as flying saucers over Washington, D.C., and right. There were photos and a short film that emerged at that time, and there are four factors that existed at that time that cannot, in my opinion, cannot be reduplicated ever, and one of them was that the limits of technology were known and demonstrated. For example, the fastest jet was our F-86 Sabre jet, which could do about 630 miles per hour, and the MiG-15 the Soviets had was about 550 miles per hour, both of which were being demonstrated daily during the Korean War at that time. And the argument is, if there was hidden technology on either side, both sides would have tried to use it in the Korean War going on, but they did not. The second factor is that people generally trusted the U.S. government, especially Harry Truman, who actually acknowledged, as I'm sure you know, on TV news, that the Joint Chiefs of Staff were discussing, quote, flying saucers. And third, people trusted the media, which was generally limited to, you know, radio, TV, newspapers, and magazines, and formed a common frame of reference that most of the people at that time trusted, for better or worse. And finally, the analog film that this stuff was documented on could not be digitally altered at that time because such technologies did not exist.
So I
don't see how any of these four factors could ever come to converge again, no matter what happened. Just people don't believe anything anymore.
Well, I'm going to let that stand because I think that you argued it well. I want to pull out two things that you said, which was the way people reported it, though, at the time is one of the ways in which it became popularly thought of, and that's these ships were metal. And so, because they're talking about the glint of the sun, and they were talking about it being metal, and I wonder, that became the common way of thinking about these quote-unquote flying saucers, which is the other thing. To be referring to them as flying saucers, when in fact there's many other shapes involved or many other types of craft, as has been reported over the years, something like Mylar didn't really exist yet, and because we didn't, if it glinted in the sun and it was flying, we thought for sure it was metal. And I've always wondered, to the degree if we had a more accurate image, that we could see better what those things were, what the skin was of those crafts. Because that's part of what we, at least for those of us that followed the story when it gets to Roswell, that is part of what we learn there, is that if it's true that that was a UAP or a UFO that had crash-landed in New Mexico, then one of the things that we learned from that is that it was all about alternative interior structure, the substructure of it, and the exterior structure of it as well. And so I think sometimes we get locked into thinking about something based on how it was being reported at the time. And if only we had a better view of it, or if only we had something that we could really zero in on, we could see that those were never metal, and that whether or not they were flying saucers, we're better off not using that term because that has become so politicized over the years and so easily dismissible. If you say, I saw a flying saucer, almost people just ordinarily laugh because of shows like My Favorite Martian or any other number of comedies that were playing off of that idea of the little Martian sitting in a little bubble top in something that was shaped like a saucer. Your thoughts on that?
You would agree that whatever it was, and the term that Truman and other people used was kind of a generic way of saying, we don't know what in the world that was. And it's more believable, it was very believable at that time, and I think it remains so, that nobody, including the Soviets, had the technology to be flying craft past Washington, getting chased by our Sabre jets, and our jets not being able to keep up with them. The Soviets had nothing like that, and we know that. Today, we don't know exactly what the Soviets, the Russians now,
or the Chinese
like that.
Right. Yeah, and that's, I think that's the operating, if we're going to have a star that we're going to steer by, what's scarier right now? I was talking about this at the Oz UFO conference. What's scarier right now? The thought that there are UFOs or UAPs that are visiting us from somewhere else that may be totally benign, or that those are a Chinese or Russian crafts, and they are so far ahead of us
technologically that we should be terrified? That, I think, is the latter. I'll answer the question for myself. East of the Rockies, Brendan is in Texas on Coast to Coast AM. Brendan?
Hello, thank you, everybody. It's always a pleasure. I just got to say real quickly, I'm a Coast to Coast insider. I work a lot at a factory, and I put on that insider, and just I listen to a lot of the older shows, and Ian, a lot of your older shows really blow me away. You know, I had told you about that, the lady that was talking about the poisonings in the early 1900s. That was a really awesome show.
Okay.
I learned a lot from that one.
Good, so, good.
What I was going to call about was this upcoming UAP disclosure, and that I just wanted to quickly say that if it's Russians or Chinese or even an alien ET threat, they're kind of just flying around us and not really doing anything, letting us photograph them, videotape them. Like, you would think if it was the Russians or the Chinese and they really hated us that bad, they would just...